Betsy has given presentations on sanitation. It is a very important topic to think about in the greenhouse. And we want to look at these cultural techniques first before we start thinking about pesticides. And so it's some very important foundational things to think about. I also will be talking about the disease aspect of sanitation. And
as always, we interrupt each other whenever we feel necessary.
That's right. We work well together as a team. So you'll be hearing us both through today's presentation. Betsy's going to lead out here.
So I wanted to take it back to where John Henderson, when he talked about what resistance, pesticide resistance was, and some basics on management. So I pulled up his first two slides, or a couple of his slides, from the first program that really do sort of relate to the concept of sanitation and why sanitation and cultural methods are so important in any kind of pest control, whether you're just looking at pest control or whether you're trying to reduce potential for pesticide management. So he had one on why is resistance so common in greenhouse pests, and one of the reasons is unlimited food supply, and that's what you're trying to do when you're looking at sanitation and cultural methods is often reducing the food supply for insects, diseases, weeds, algae. We're going to talk about all those different things. And then also he had a slide really talking about cultural and physical control. And if you look at that all of the things he had listed there are really sanitation, clean greenhouse, clean plant materials, stay clean, monitor, avoid overwatering, prune or rogue out infestations. Those things all come into the idea of sanitation and cultural control. So if you really want to know what sanitation is, I looked at Merriam-Webster's dictionary definition, and they are talking about disease, but it does apply to other organisms when you're looking at greenhouses. And sanitation is the promotion of healthy practices and the prevention of disease or insect pests or weeds or algae by maintenance of sanitary conditions. It's a little circular, but that's where we're starting from. I also found this to be quite interesting. This is an article from Grower Talks in December 2009 on the concept of sanitation and looking at cleanliness and the message it sends to employees and customers that sanitation is an attitude. And I think that's definitely true, that it does, if you have a place that looks like you're taking care of it and that you're keeping it clean, it also has an effect on sales and how your employees continue to maintain sanitation. So I just do that into something a little different. So in terms of what we're talking about today with sanitation and cultural control, we're talking about all the different pests you might have, insects, diseases, weeds, and algae. And we'll go over those all. There's different means and methods for some of them, and some are very similar. The other thing to think about when you're talking about how organisms are coming into your greenhouse is to remember they can come in from the outside or they can be moving around on the inside. So when you're considering how to keep those populations low, you need to consider both outside, whether things come in plant materials or media, or the inside, whether they can be maintained on floors or structures or pots, or if you have stock or pet plants in the greenhouse, that's a great place, particularly for insects and some diseases as well, to be maintained at a population that is higher than you really want in your greenhouse. So looking at sanitation for insect management, there's a few things that we're always considering, sort of looking at it from the point of view of insects, and those are nice insect eyes down in the picture, so that's a good point of view picture. From the point of view of the insect, they're looking at food sources, hiding places, and dispersal, how they might move around the greenhouse. And those are all aspects of the insect life cycle that we can affect to help with sanitation or use looking at ways to cultural control to control them. So for example, there are certain insects in a greenhouse that must have living plant material to survive. Whiteflies, aphids, and broad or cyclamen mites don't survive very long without living plants. They don't have any diapause or hibernation. They can't survive in cracks in the benches or in the structure. They have to have living plant material. That makes them, in some respects, a little easier to control. And so in terms of sanitation, what does this mean? It means if you have infested or infected plants, you need to remove them as soon as possible. They'd be infested since we're talking about insects. Also, consider how they're removed. If you pick up a plant pot that's full of whiteflies and you walk it down the walkway and take it outside, you may have left a fair number of whiteflies behind. And we've had examples of that, other growers where they had mealybug in one location in the greenhouse and they removed the plants and then suddenly they had a mealybug in all the plants along the walkway. So bag them or do something so that, put them in a trash can, do something so they're covered so you're not spreading them as you're removing them. The other thing is removing all plants as soon as possible at the end of the season. That's sometimes a hard one to do because you're at the end of the season and really kind of tired of being in the greenhouse. But anything you can do to clean up the greenhouse and leave it clean in any periods where there where you don't have any plants in there is an advantage. So that also applies to weed management. And that's sometimes a hard one in that you can leave a greenhouse not seeing any plants, any weeds in it, and come back in the middle of the summer perhaps and find that you do have weeds growing in there. So you may need to check back, make sure that you continue with your weed management in the greenhouse, and certainly particularly look for plants that are infested, but really look for any plants. This is an example of one that we found at a greenhouse where they had had very good whitefly control, couldn't figure out why they weren't controlling their whiteflies all of a sudden. And we found this one, there's a poke plant in the back of the picture there that was absolutely loaded with whiteflies. It wasn't in the greenhouse, but it was in the headhouse area. And so when we're talking about removing all plant material, it's often in a wider area than you'd think of in terms of just the greenhouse. Then there are some insects that can survive without living plant material. The pupae can survive in the soil. If you have, you don't even have to have dirt floors, you could have gravel floors where enough potting mix has fallen down in between the cracks, they'll survive in there. Fungus gnat larvae can survive in the soil. In general, they need moisture and microorganisms to survive. But there's a lot of microorganisms in soil mix even that we don't expect, and they need surprisingly little moisture. Plus, there are often ways that moisture gets into greenhouses even when you're not using them. And then two-spotted spider mite actually forms an overwintering type. This time of year, sometimes if in a greenhouse, you can go find sort of orange colored, I've got a picture of it that I'll show you in a minute, spider mites, and they can survive cold temperatures. And so they're ready, and they don't have to be on plants, and they can be there ready when you bring plants in, and then they'll come out of that stage. So there's the orange colored overwintering spider mites. I've seen them on greenhouses in New York, so I know they're there. The other thing, too, and we're talking about media and dirt floors and things surviving in media, your media where you're storing it can also be a place that fungus gnats in particular will survive. We've done some tests with media that had been stored a variety of different ways and found quite a number, particularly in the media that was stored in open bins in the Cornell greenhouses, quite a number of fungus gnats hatching out of those media samples. And so, again, there's another place that they can find microorganisms and moisture, and they'll happily survive there. Diseases also can survive in some situations. But that's Brian's part. In terms of sanitation for insects that can survive without plant material, so compost piles or debris away from the crop, we don't see too many compost piles backed up against greenhouses, but every once in a while, if there's a lot of plant material that needs to be disposed of, you'll end up with a pile near the house. Spilled growing media, clean it up as well as you can. Not very many people go. I did see one small greenhouse where they actually vacuumed the gravel floors to get the media up from between the gravel. That's pretty hard to ask for, but if you can do anything to reduce the amounts of it, that helps. Store your growing media in a dry place and keep it covered. Keep your greenhouse dry. Some of these have to do with while there's plant material in, but also if you can let it dry down when the greenhouse is empty, that will certainly help. And leaks in that case, I mean, leaks where you've got dripping water, that's one where it's hard to think about those when you're not using the greenhouse. You don't notice things that are leaking, but that's a way to get moisture into the greenhouse. Other ways to, it's interesting to see when something covers up the slide. Bagging, removing plant debris, or covering trash cans. In terms of, again, looking at sanitation, this doesn't have to do so much with whether or not the insects will survive with or without plant material. But when you've got a greenhouse in the spring and you're doing, you're cutting back material or a variety of other activities, you end up with plant debris. And often, I mean, most people, that I've not seen too many people dropping it on the floor. That's good. That's an encouraging sign. But even putting it in a trash can, we kind of forget that just because we put it in the trash can, the insects can fly or move or crawl out, and disease spores can fly out if it's not covered. This is an experiment that was done by Brian Hogendorf and Ray Cloyd. They put a yellow sticky card in the lid of a trash can that was used for plant debris. This was in a university greenhouse. And the numbers are not so important on that graph, but just looking at numbers of insects that were coming out per month for the white flies, which are those really tall, dark purple lines, they're up over 1,000 in some cases in a month. That's a lot of white flies to fly out of the trash can. And when white flies fly out of a trash can, they're going to go look for someplace to land and lay eggs and start the whole system over again. So a little bit of covering and sanitation will help you a lot in the long run. We're also doing the best you can to examine all plant material coming into the greenhouse. That's easier for some things than others. This is a diagram of thrips eggs that are actually laid in the plant tissue. And it's very difficult to see them, if not impossible, when you're getting plant material and you're looking at it. So you can have a thrips infestation that you don't see when plant material comes in. But if you've got plant material coming in and you can actually see insects on it, you need to deal with those before they get into the greenhouse, if at all possible, so that you can reduce the potential for the insect population increasing, and often fast. If you've got a plant that's infested or could be also infected, throw it out, and the sooner the better. Bag it on the way out. If you're leaving it there hoping that it will recover, there's an awful lot of costs involved in that, and we often don't think about those, and it's hard to throw things out that you paid for or you've been growing for a while. The other thing is, if you take something out, you might want to treat or certainly examine the plants that are around those that you remove to make sure that there's not a few hitchhikers that have migrated a little bit off the plants that are really obviously infested. And we'll stay there and increase the population.
So this slide really goes for both insects and diseases. Now we're going to move into a little bit of the disease discussion on sanitation.
You think? Nope, we've got one more.
Oh.
So, I changed things around. Brian hasn't seen where I put the slides. So sometimes people want to freeze or cook out insects in an empty house. And it does get some of them, certainly the ones that require plant material, as long as there's no plants there, that will help. but as we saw before, some can form resistant stages, and some are pretty tolerant of very hot and very cold temperatures, so it's not a perfect method for removing insects from a greenhouse. Okay.
Now we're talking about disease management and sanitation. It's an important topic because spores can get spread around. We're going to take a look at this slide a little bit later, but let's talk about those fungal spores that might be out there. They are adapted for dispersal and survival. They're very small, and that allows them to be dispersed, to float around like dust. And you can see that they really fit into that spore. The spore size fits into the size of dust particles, and so they can just float through the air. And you know, when you see a stream of light coming through and you see that dust in your house, the same thing can be happening in a greenhouse where some of those dust particles are actually spores. And if they land on a suitable environment on a plant, then they can germinate, like the picture there, the electron microscopic picture of a spore that is germinating on the leaf surface. Here, we normally can't see individual spores here when they're clustered together, when they're all releasing at the same time, we can see them. And you can get an idea that these are just very small and can be blown around with the slightest bit of air movement. And those were spores from this disease that can occur in high tunnels and in greenhouses on tomatoes. It's known as white mold in a lot of crops, and it can affect many different types of plants, vegetables, as well as ornamentals grown in greenhouses or high tunnels. when it affects tomatoes, we refer to this white mold as timber rot. And many times the spores will actually come in from outside, but they can overwinter and start up from inside the greenhouse as well. So this is one where sanitation inside and maybe immediately surrounding the greenhouse can be helpful. Here it is on some dahlias, and we have another shot of that here where we see the fungal disease is affecting the base of these plants. And again, these spores came through the air, and in this case, they found a suitable environment where there's a lot of humidity at the base of these dahlia plants in a peat pot in a greenhouse. This was just taken previous year. And in this one, you can also see a survival structure, that dark area right in the middle of the slide to your right. That is something that can survive in the greenhouse, can survive outdoors. It can also produce a mushroom-like structure that can release spores that can travel through air currents. So sanitation is important. In this case, the greenhouse grower removed all of these affected plants and really kept an eye on those around it. So they lost of these fiber pots, probably only 6 or 7, and then just really kept an eye on that area. But these were taken away in a bag so that they weren't able to grow on and the spores weren't able to be released even outside the greenhouse where the spores could come back in. Botrytis is certainly one of the most common, and because of its prevalence in greenhouse crops, one of the most important diseases in greenhouses and high tunnels. And these are a couple shots of the spores of botrytis that are held up on these black fungal structures. The spores are relatively colorless, and the combination gives it the gray coloration that we call it gray mold is one of its common names.
And just like plants that hold their seeds up in a way for them to be dispersed, that's true of these fungi also, that you see they're not like down in the mycelium, they're up so that when the wind blows or an air current goes by, they can be moved.
That's a great point. And here, you know, we have cyclamen is susceptible to botrytis that can spread around in the air. And if you take a close look, we're going to look at this leaf here. If we take a close look at that, it looks all right from a distance, but wow, this is infected with botrytis, and all of those spores are there. And as Betsy mentioned, with little bits of air current, they are going to be floating around. And if they land again on a damp portion of a plant, like the crown, if they find their way in there where water is on the petioles for extended periods of time because there's less air current and it stays there, then infection can take place. So there we have botrytis getting started in the center of the cyclamen plant. And cyclamens are growing a little bit cooler. Gray mold likes that type of condition as well. So here we're going to talk about sanitation, and this one is difficult because we're growing plants like this New Guinea impatient for the flowers, but when it's flowering, really before we're ready to sell the plant, it can be a little bit of a liability. Botrytis, gray mold really likes decaying flower parts and weak portions of a plant. And when the petal or the flower is starting to naturally senesce or die, then it becomes very susceptible to botrytis. Botrytis gets started there, and then when it's actively growing and a portion of it is connected or lands on the plant that is healthy and actively growing, then it can infect, as you see here. So it moved from the flower petal to the leaf. And so in this case, probably getting in, having somebody with a bag there to pinch out these infected portions and getting them away from that plant would be the best way to do some cleanup. That's not always practical to do but when you can, it's a good idea.
Another place where we knew you were going to say that. I was going to say another place where we see this happen a lot is where you've got hanging baskets, and it looks like the next slide has pictures of plants over plants, and you'll have petals dropping down on plants below.
Good introduction. So here we're talking about that type of sanitation where we saw in the previous slide that those petals are the type of material that Botrytis really likes to get started because it's naturally dying, it's very weak. And when that's showering down on the dense growth of coleus, in this case below, then it's a situation where disease can really get started. So can you avoid hanging plants above your benches? No. You know, in the spring before sales start, you will have a crowded situation like that. It's just important to be aware that this is the type of situation where diseases like Botrytis can really get going. So extra scouting, paying attention in these types of situations is important.
And cultural control in terms of the management of or ventilation and management of humidity in the greenhouse.
Yes. Move on up. So here's just another situation where this can be a problem. And in this case below, we actually did have some Botrytis getting started there. It's not only from the petals falling down, but also from the moisture that may drain through the pots if they receive maybe a little bit too much water. The water can create areas below that are very susceptible. And just one more shot, you know, Botrytis is very important in the greenhouse, and virtually every crop is susceptible. Here's a nice shot of Botrytis on snapdragons. So one of the management tools for Botrytis that is commonly used, in addition to those cultural techniques, are fungicides. And here are some of the fungicides that were used, but Botrytis has developed resistance to these fungicides. And so, you know, that's what this webinar series is about, is talking about ways to manage our fungicide tools so that this doesn't happen. And it has happened with these, and in some cases, it has occurred even on other Botrytis fungicides. And unfortunately, the Botrytis spores move around with plant material, so you're likely to have Botrytis that is resistant, even if you were doing some rotation in your own greenhouses, because these do move throughout the industry, the fungi as well as the plant material. And that is why cultural controls are so important, because we can't rely just on fungicides. And I'm finishing up part of my disease section here with this, these shots here. So here we have a trash can that was in a greenhouse, and there at the bottom were, you know, some pots and some plant debris. And in there we have this geranium flower, the spent flower that was pruned off, maybe because it had Botrytis on it. And there it is, actively sporulating. Because there's enough other plant material there, there was a moist environment and the spores were being produced, and they could be coming out of there with little air currents and moving around the greenhouse. So sanitation is good, but you want to take it to the next step and get that plant material out of there, putting it in a bag, tying it up, and disposing of that so the spores cannot spread around. Black root rot also can be a long-term resident in the greenhouse. So this is one, so we get concerned about it on the surface. Botrytis can really move around in the air. This is one that can adhere to pots and porous surfaces. So we really want to be aware of that. It can also certainly infect the media. So here's one that we might not recognize that has black root rot, but this petunia was infected with black root rot. I'm not going to talk about the diagnosis so much this time. We will next week in the scouting, but black root rot does cause the roots to have this really dark color to them. And that's just because of all the spores that are packed in there. They have black colored spores. Talk about that again a little bit next week. But the fungal spores can be found on the benches and the potting areas. Definitely in reused containers. If you suspect black root rot, be sure not to reuse those containers. It's even difficult to sterilize those containers to a good degree so that you can use those containers again. Plant material, including stock plants. I have seen this on some stock plants, and even though you might be taking cuttings and away from the media, it can get spread around because these spores can get splashed away from the roots and on to the area that you might be taking the cuttings from. And this is one where fungus gnats can actually ingest this when they're in the soil as larvae, and they can have it in their system. So when they're flying around to the next plant, they can leave fungal spores in a previously healthy plant.
The fiends.
Yes. So sanitation is really important for black root rot, disinfecting the benches in the best way you can, cleaning trays and containers, and again, keeping those fungus gnats under control, because that is a sanitation technique that's important to control this disease. And Betsy has worked with some growers that, you know, have done their best to control diseases with sanitation.
Yeah, so I just put in a few slides of some other things to think about. I mean, the thing with sanitation is, things are moving. Anyway, we'll go past that slide. I didn't realize there's multiple ones. But other things to think about in terms of cleanliness, and that's what sanitation, a lot of it is, a lot of it's common sense. And also sometimes you have to pay attention. We also can see from slides that be careful when we come into your greenhouses, because we always have our cameras. But it's really easy to, you know, if you finish watering and you put the hose end down and it's all on the ground and you don't notice that it's sitting in a puddle, and then if there's fungal spores around and they're now adhered to the head of the wand of the for watering, you may spread them to the next plants over. And some ways too is in terms of if you can make it easier, it's much more likely to happen. So if there's a way to keep your hoses off the ground or to hang up the hose end so that it doesn't end up on the ground or on the bench where it could get infected. That just makes it faster, and it makes it so that it becomes habit, and then it's a lot easier if you don't have to think about it quite so much. I don't know where all these pictures are coming from. It's very exciting. One of the things that I put in just as kind of an interest, there are some people that do use some foot baths, not very commonly, which is the concept of keeping organisms out of the greenhouse, and in this case, primarily these organisms rather than insects. But one, you have to use them. I've seen people walk around them because they don't want to get the bottoms of their shoes wet. The other thing is I found information that says you should be changing the solution a minimum of twice daily. I'm sure that's based on the number of people going in and out of your greenhouse, but you need to think about anything that has disinfectants in it. And we're not talking too much about disinfectants today, but just to note that this is a situation where you do use a disinfectant that you need to know enough about them so that you're actually getting the control you think you're getting. I was kind of interested. I never have heard of any resistance developing to disinfectants, and it may be that it takes it's a different mode of action concept, and therefore you're less likely to get it happening. But certainly, it's something to pay attention to also. The other thing is we often don't think about is something like hand washing. When we're talking about viruses, there are some of them that you can easily spread on your hands, on your clothing, other ways. And so that concept of sanitation is something to consider also. So we've got a little bit on weed management in here. I know we've got a lot of information that we're giving you all at once today, and that's why we like to have these. We're glad these things will be archived and you can go back and look at them when you want to. The other point that I wanted to make, thinking about disinfectants also, is we've got some handouts that we're working on getting up on the website, and we'll send out information on those once they're up there. But some from, so background information on resistance, some of the IRAC and FRAC and HRAC all the resistance organizations, some of their information, and then some information on disinfectants and other things also that work as sort of background to this talk that we're doing. So weed management, I like to put this picture up because this weed in particular is kind of diabolical. It has little capsules. Once it flowers, it has capsules. And those little brown things that look sort of insect-like are oxalis seeds. And then the capsules open, it shoots the seeds out quite a distance, and they're sticky. So they stick to walls, they stick to pots, they stick in a lot of different places. So we tend to see the large weed and think, okay, you got to get that out of there. We may not see the seeds that are left behind because often they're very small and again can land in places where soil has fallen in between cracks of gravel or whatever. And so if you can do nothing else in terms of weed management, get rid of them before they go to seed, but hopefully you can get the plant, the whole plant out entirely.
Mm-hmm. And they're going to be harvesting potentially or harboring potentially insects and diseases, viruses. So
you name it, just about.
Yeah.
So if you can avoid ever having them, that's great, but that's very difficult to do. Once you have them, because there's not very many pesticides labeled for greenhouses, and because we're talking about pesticide management and looking at sanitation and other methods, you're limited to hand pulling. There are some people that have used fire. That's a little dangerous in a greenhouse that's either got plastic all over it or wood benches or whatever. And the main one is sort of trying to keep some of the water and fertilizer away. There's a question mark there because you're in a greenhouse that's full of water and fertilizer, and it's very difficult to keep any from landing on the floor. The other problem often in greenhouses, and this picture is an example where the benches are stationary, having to climb in under there and really get those weeds out is difficult. So avoiding them at all cost is important, but then once you get them is to really work at getting rid of them.
Preventing those seeds from getting into that soil below.
And then pulling them out when they do. And it's better to start sooner than later because it will be a problem that does increase pretty dramatically. And most of those seeds can tolerate both hot and cold temperatures. And so freezing them or cooking them out doesn't work. Also remember that you've got weeds from the outside. That's where many of them are coming in. There's different things you can do. You can mow along the edge. Notice both these greenhouses have open sides, so anything that's flowering and going to seed, a lot of weeds have very small seeds that can be moved by wind, and they will blow right in the greenhouse. On the picture, looking at it on my right, you can see that they had mulch there to provide sort of a barrier, but then didn't keep up with it, and so now they've got weeds growing right up against the shade also. So I'm going to move to algae management. I seem to have a lot on algae all of a sudden, but also part of some of what we're talking about on algae relates to weeds as well. So algae are photosynthetic but non-flowering plants. You can have single-celled ones, you can have large colonies, and we can see both in greenhouses. They are annoying, if not more than that, for several reasons. You can form an algae impermeable layer on the media, and so the water sits on the top and doesn't actually get down into the roots. They clog irrigation and misting lines. They make walkways slippery. Oh, there's lots of reasons we don't like them. They're a breeding habitat for shore flies. They compete for water and nutrients. You know, my mom always told me to say one nice thing about somebody if you're saying a bunch of bad things. So they don't cause any direct damage to plants. That's about the only thing that we can say about them. And then how do they get? They seem to get everywhere. And so one of the things, if you have a colony of algae, it will fragment. If it dries up, it becomes dust, just like the spores from fungi. And then they also do sometimes produce resting spores that are meant as survival structures, and those can move around the greenhouse as well. There's another whole interesting thought of looking at algae coming in with water systems, and not just water systems from ponds or wells where you might, well, not so much wells, but ponds where you might expect it, but even municipal water systems. And so it's kind of another one where you assume that algae is there and just trying to prevent it from interfering with what you're doing and growing where you don't want it to be. So the biggest thing in terms of algae, this does apply to some extent to weeds also, is reducing the sources of water that it can survive on. So if you can water less, dry growing helps. You've got less water that's hitting the floor, or it just dries out more in between waterings. Using media with better drainage will also help preventing, this is mostly for algae growing on the pots. Look at how water drains in your greenhouse. So are the walkways sloped? Do you have leaking pipes? Are there places where it always puddles? And then the question is, can you do something about those? Sometimes you can. Sometimes it's a question of putting more gravel in an area or doing something to prevent water from standing in a location. And sometimes it's much more difficult to do. The other thing too is if you've got drips coming down from condensation on your roof, if there's a way to deal with where those drips land and if they drain from that point or if they build up. Reducing nutrients, again, it's a food source for the algae as well. It's difficult to reduce anything that comes to the pots because you actually do want a certain amount of excess watering so that they leach through. But if you can reduce the amount that lands on the floor where algae might build up, and then again, avoiding puddling and poor drainage where the nutrients can build up in those puddles. Then hiding places. Piles of old pots, sometimes you can find algae happily growing in there. It's just moist enough and there's just enough nutrition to let to survive. Wood benches are difficult to get rid of algae. It gets in between the, or gets in cracks and crevices, and it's very difficult to clean out, even if you're using disinfectants. Some structures seem to build up algae on the walls and so forth, and you really need to get in there and clean that off, even if it's not directly affecting the plants right there. Again, it can move from that location to be in the plant. And then if you've got propagation areas, or especially if you've got mist benches where it's impossible to not have too much water, because that's the point, that if you can do anything you can do to reduce the amount of algae there is helpful. So we've got lots of time. Anyway, so I've just put a note in here, and we've got lots of time for questions. But a lot of sanitation is common sense and some planning and above all time, because it's something that you have to do in addition to all the other things you're doing. It's one of the things that I think in between seasons when you've got a little time is to go in and do some planning. Look for drips, look for leaking things, look for places where weed seeds can come in, or look for ways that insects or diseases might come into the house. Do some of your planning then and save yourself some time when you really don't have it later when you have a house full of plants. Okay.
All right, so that concludes the formal presentation part of our webinar for today, but we do have time. We'd love to answer a few questions if you have any. And if you could enter those in through the chat box, we will look for those there. And you can send those to everybody, or you can send them to myself, Brian Eshenaur. That would probably be the best way to do that, because we're checking on my end of things here. So Betsy and I will both be able to respond to any of those questions.
Other comments that you can make too, we're always interested in finding out how this works for you and whether you can hear us and we're not bopping in and out. This is a different one, and that we're both using the same computer as a microphone, so hopefully we weren't turning away from it too much. And it looks like we have a question.
Yeah, we have a couple that have come in. Thank you for those. The first is, what would you suggest for cleaning pansy pots to get rid of Polybiopsis, which is black root rot? And pansies, I don't think I mentioned that, but pansies are very susceptible to black root rot. I personally wouldn't suggest saving those pots, because I think it's going to be very difficult to control. You may try to use one of your sanitation products that you use to clean your benches, but I think it's going to be pretty difficult. We know that those Polybiopsis, those black rot, root rot spores are pigmented. They're very resistant to breaking down, and it's probably better just to start fresh with new pots with that disease.
The other thing is, if you're trying to save them and use them with crops that are less susceptible, that's the best I can suggest. But the other thing then is you have to remember which ones are which. And then that's another added time and planning thing, that you have to be able to put them aside so that you know which ones potentially had Polybiopsis, or you know for sure had Polybiopsis, so you don't use them on something susceptible. There's another question on use of acetic acid or sulfur for weed control under benches. Acetic acid, I know more about that than sulfur. There's certainly work that's been done on using vinegar for weed management outside. The biggest issue that I know about using vinegar, for a couple things that I can think about using vinegar for acetic acid for weed control, the levels that you want, the concentration is higher than what you would buy in household vinegar, and then consequently, the higher the concentration, the more you need to worry about burning from if it is an acid. And it's also difficult to get hold of and sometimes getting those higher concentrations. The other thing is, if you're talking about small weeds just coming up, the vinegar does work pretty well. It's basically a burn down product and it'll burn them back. But if you're talking about a weed that's got any kind of storage root or is a perennial that comes back, it's very difficult to get any kind of control. Now, we've seen everything on weeds in greenhouses. One of the most interesting was a greenhouse that had such wet floors, it had horsetails. It had a huge population of horsetails in it. And the problem, of course, is when the first few came in, they probably didn't look. They looked at them and thought, oh, that's not much of anything. And then pretty soon they had lots. So in terms of vinegar, in terms of it being labeled for greenhouses, I don't think it is. Same problem with sulfur. And then since you're using them as a pesticide product, they do need to be labeled for the location. And I don't really know anything about sulfur weed management, even outside. So maybe somebody else has information there.
And one reason that there's very few herbicide products labeled for the greenhouse is because in a greenhouse environment, you can get drift, you can get volatilization that's captured because you're inside a structure. And so herbicide damage of greenhouse crops is it's a huge issue. And we even have cases where an herbicide wasn't used, but it was stored in the greenhouse and it volatilized and crops were affected. And of course, when the sides are open, herbicide can drift in from the outside. So there's a reason that there's very few herbicides available for the greenhouse.
Marjorie's talking about sulfur and powdery mildew, and that's true. And even then, though, some ways of reducing sulfur in the greenhouse are not labeled for use in New York. There was a question on the best sanitizer to put through a drip irrigation line. I have to go look that one up, Larry, because I have to remember which ones you can do that with and which ones you can't. In some cases, if you're talking about putting it on just in terms of cleaning the sanitizer, I have heard of people using acid solutions for that. Again, you have to be careful, and that's not a sanitizer per se. It's trying to kill out anything that's in the drip irrigation lines. I will find out the answer, and I will we'll put it up on the web somehow to go to this, and I'll also send it out in my little e-newsletter, my little whatever they are, updates. But that's a great question, and that is something that not everybody has drip irrigation, but it's really easy to have biofilms almost build up in drip irrigation lines. They don't have a very big diameter, and so if you get anything that's sort of creating clogs, you need to actually clean out those lines.
Yeah, and in addition to the recorded webinar, we will have resources up on the IPM website that houses this series, so we can include the information about greenhouse drip irrigation sanitation products
and sanitation products in general. We're learning something all the time with the system, so we're learning how to do the archived talks too, so that will we'll get up there as well. What else? Marjorie says to draw sad faces on your pots that had boliviopsis.
If there are no other questions.
Or if we can even, if people want to actually ask them, we can unmute somebody.
Yeah, if you would like to do that, we'd be happy to do that, and maybe we can go down and unmute it.
We'll see what noises we get when we do that.
If you'd like to ask a question via your microphone, we can questions in that way. Whoa,
Oh, buzzes. We learned that we talk faster than we think. Look at that copy.
Yeah, but if there are no other questions, then, you know, if you can, please join us next week. We'll be talking about scouting, both for insects and diseases, Dan Gillerine, and we'll be talking about insects, sticky cards, and all of those ways we can scout for insects and how important that is, too, in greenhouse pest management. And also, we'll be talking about disease scouting.
And we always love feedback. So, you know, feel free to contact us one way or another. Topics that are coming up, if there's something you really want to know about, we'll try and fit it in or answer it some other way.
All right. So thanks again for joining us this week, and we hope you can join in for future webinars.
Thanks. Bye.
Thanks.